bring in
a psychiatrist, psychologist or psychiatrist?
We're the schedule's all screwed up today. So let me bring in Professor Ben Burgis, and you stay, Pete. Professor Ben Burgis is a columnist for Jacobin. He is the host of Give Them an Argument, and that's the name of his book, Give Them an Argument, Logic for the Left. And if he can unmute himself, we would be able to hear his voice. Hello there, Professor Ben Burgis. Do you know Pete Dominic?
Do not.
You should do his show.
I was about to just take over, as I have in the past, your podcast and interview Professor Burgis. But before I do that, I would just invite him to be on my show next week.
Yes, you would be well advised.
I'm familiar with his work. So even though he's not familiar with my work, which is, you know.
Pete Dominic is an alpha male.
On CNN.
And I screwed up the scheduling today.
On Real Time with Bill Maher.
Okay. How did you think? I know everybody is asking.
For 14 years.
See what he's doing to me? He's an alpha male.
Right. That's what they do.
That's what they do. You teach logic. What advice would you have given Joe Biden going into the debate? You can go on YouTube and watch Professor Ben Burgis debate some of the worst human beings on the planet. You go into the lion's den and take on the right wingers. What advice would you have given Joe Biden before the debate? How did he do? And could you debate? It's not a debate, but could you get into the arena with
And then when you're
Donald
done answering
Trump?
David's question, I actually have a better question, but go ahead.
Okay, I look forward to it. I wouldn't have given Joe Biden any advice that would have been helpful or applicable, because I would have assumed that Trump would have acted the way he did in his 2016 debates with Hillary, or in his, like, all the Republican debates in 2015, 2016, which was not like that, right? He'd do a little bit of that, right? He had, like, the occasional little spicy interjection, in those earlier debates, but it wasn't anything like the debate that just happened. That was new. And so, honestly, as the other person there, I'm not entirely sure. I'm not entirely sure what you're supposed to do in that
but
case.
But you've debated animals.
Yeah.
Stefan Molyneux. I mean, you debate people who talk over you and interrupt.
Sure.
And so how do you...
Gavin McGinnis called me a smug... Actually, I don't think I could repeat that phrase on a family-friendly program like this one, but yeah.
You debated Gavin McGinnis.
I did, yeah.
The founder of the Proud Boys.
That's right, yep. Very briefly, because after about 10 minutes in, he said something that I thought was very funny, not intentionally, and I started laughing, and he got mad that I was laughing and called me a smug C-word.
Right, right.
And then that was the end of it, but... Yep.
So you debate the format of the debate. Should we blame the Presidential Commission on Debates having just Chris Wallace asking the questions as opposed to a real debate? What would a real debate look like? And would a traditional debate, would the format have forced Trump to be controlled?
Well, I don't know, right? Because you could have done more structure. You could have had like an Oxford-style debate where they would have, you know, had like 5-minute opening statements and 5-minute rebuttals and all that stuff. But it seemed like Trump wasn't really paying attention to the format that he was given, right? I mean, like he was running over the time limits and again, I mean, it wasn't just an occasional thing. It was like every single, like, I don't know that there were more than a few complete sentences that, you know, that Biden got out without interruption. So it seemed like Trump just wasn't going to, just wasn't going to respect whatever format he was given. I've heard the suggestion since then that maybe they could have like cut his mic or something like that. And depending on how far away they were standing, maybe that would have worked. But Pete had a better question, I heard.
My question is about media and why certain formats, quote, succeed better than others. This week, I spent a lot of time looking at YouTube, generally YouTube shows. And I don't want to mention this guy's name because I just don't want to, but he's got a million followers on social media and subscribers. He's part of now a bigger platform on Glenn Beck's The Blaze. But it's really fascinating to me, and it's always been fascinating to me, why conservative talkers are so successful, so much more, quote, successful, and however we define that success, than liberal talkers. Yeah. My theory has always been that the only liberal kind of political media that really succeeds and cuts through are the comedians. And, you know, I worked at the Colbert Report and the Daily Show, which is why I created my radio show at SiriusXM that you never heard of. But I, you know, that's the John Oliver, Bill Maher. They're the only ones that really do well. And unless you have a platform behind you like MSNBC, and even then, they really generally don't compare. And so my question to you is, seeing as that you debate them and you're a psychiatrist.
We're having a psychiatrist on in 20 minutes.
I'm sorry. You're a
professor
of philosophy.
Philosophy.
Same thing.
Yeah. You're supposed to say that's any better?
One of them can prescribe drugs. One of them can't, right? But no, my question is, why do you think that is? Why do they dominate? Why do they have millions of people that watch them more than more liberal minded hosts of shows?
Yeah, I mean, so I guess it's not 100% true now, depending on what you're thinking of as far as like liberal hosts, right? I mean, relative to the fact that cable news isn't what it was, you know, like Rachel Maddow, for example, does get really big audiences now.
Not as big as Joe Rogan.
Not as big as Joe Rogan, although Joe Rogan is, I would argue, it's like in some ways Joe Rogan is to Rachel's left, you know, for one thing, he supported Bernie Sanders in the primary, and Maddow certainly didn't, to put it mildly, right?
But he also said he was going to vote for Trump over Biden.
I don't think you can say Joe Rogan is to Rachel Maddow's left.
I think it depends what you mean. I think on certain issue, like, look, I think Joe Rogan is a mess politically. You know, he's all over the place.
He's complicated.
But, you know, I mean, I think he's like most people who don't think and talk about politics all the time, right? I mean, like, they probably, like, you know, I've listened to Rogan enough that I think like 10% of his guests are political, right? You know, like maybe more lately. But, you know, he's at least as interested in mixed martial arts and psychedelics and half a dozen other things as he is
exercise
in politics
and fitness.
And so I think, like, a lot of people who don't, you know, eat, sleep, and, you know, breathe, drink and breathe this stuff, you know, he's got a bunch of political impulses. But he hasn't necessarily thought about it enough that those impulses have like cohered together into a consistent worldview. So you can watch, like, when he would have Dave Rubin on, he doesn't anymore.
He's a great example.
Well, I was just going to say, though, that
I know him. I tried to save his job at SiriusXM many years ago. We were pretty good friends. We came up together in the New York comedy scene, and I knew that he was, you know, very conservative only when it came to Israel.
Yeah.
But, you know, he was gay and openly gay and, you know, a thoughtful guy. And then it's so upsetting.
Which proves that you can be gay and Jewish and still be an effing idiot.
I don't know if he's an idiot. I mean, I agree.
Oh, he's an idiot. He's an idiot. He's taking money from the Koch brothers.
Well,
that's the only smart thing he's ever done.
He succeeded.
I will say, whether or not you want to call him an idiot, like, if you watch when he was on Rogan and they got into it about the post office and regulation.
Yeah, he made him look like it. Rogan made him look like a silly goose, I feel, in that moment.
And it's not the only. Anyway, all I was going to say.
Bob Saget goes on the show and is going, this guy's a. Go ahead, Ben. Sorry,
no.
Professor Ben.
Thank you, comedian David. All I was going to say is that some of those impulses, I think, honestly, really and truly, right? He's not as, like, obviously clearly in terms of partisan alignment, right? Like, he's, you know, Rachel Maddow is a very loyal Democrat. Rogan said, oh yeah, Biden's senile, I might have to vote for Trump, right? You know,
right,
so like,
right.
In that sense, sure. But in terms of things like Medicare for All, and in terms of the primary and entering, you know, like, I think there are places where Rogan's impulses are very social democratic, whereas Maddow's more of a mainstream liberal, right? But I, as far as your original question, I mean, I think that Maddow has gotten to have that big audience now because in some ways she's feeding people the same kind of red meat about, you know, Russia and all this stuff that's like in some ways reminiscent of what like a lot of the right-wing people do. But before that, you know, before that, right? I mean, she, like way back when she was on Air America Radio, which is actually a pretty good demonstration of what I think part of the answer to your question is, because if you think back to the bizarre saga of Air America,
right? Can I, Pete, smooth
and steady funding sources of right wing radio. I think that is at least. I mean, it's not interested. It's not counterintuitive, but I think that is part of the answer.
Can I, Pete? Is it okay if I interrupt and ask him a question?
I guess. I mean, it's your show.
Thank you.
I mean, it's not like you don't have my show. And
he's an alpha. And Professor Ben Burgis, what should a debate be? You debate. You wrote the book, Give Them an Argument. Your podcast is called Give Them an Argument. What should a presidential debate look like? I think the commission should be blamed for this, the format and course.
Well, if you think they should be blamed, what do you think the format should have been?
Traditionally, debates were not hosted by one journalist and turned into their flagship product for his or her newsroom. I mean, they turned this into, look how great Chris Wallace is, watch him Sunday morning. Traditionally, the debates had a panel of journalists asking questions. Originally, that's what Meet the Press was. You go back to the debates that resumed in 76, there was a period, you know, they had the presidential debate in 1960. Nixon supposedly lost, although people who heard it on the radio said he won. Nobody wanted to have a debate again. And then Carter and Ford had a debate in 76, and it became a tradition. At the beginning, it was a panel of journalists asking questions. Now it's one guy asking questions because he can negotiate with both sides and get...
Okay. But if there was a panel,
they can play one ref, they can't play six. So it should be at least six reporters asking the question.
But if there had been a panel of six people on Tuesday, do you think it would have made a difference?
Yes.
I mean, how? Like
because you had it. It was three men on stage. You can't.
One of them would have had a slingshot.
I mean, if they had, then yeah, that might have made a difference. But I guess
you have to outnumber Trump. You have to have decency.
Why can't they just have control of the microphone? You agree to these rules. If you don't, I'll just turn your microphone down.
Well, that's what
and
they're
no
saying.
One will be able to. Yeah, that's a fine solution. It's actually a great solution.
I mean, that actually seems like it would have solved what the issue was on Tuesday. Like normally, the problem with presidential debates is exactly the opposite. That there's no that they just sort of very politely give parallel speeches and never really engage with what the other person is saying, right? Like, so it's not a real debate. Like that was always the complaint back in like 2004, 2008, 2012. Like that was the complaint that people used to make. But this is the exact opposite, right? The problem is that nobody had time to express a thought because Trump made it so clear that he was going to just constantly interrupt. So yeah, I mean, I think.
How would you fix the format?
Well, I think as far as fixing the format from Tuesday, I agree with Pete. I think literally just cutting the mic to enforce time limits would have solved the immediate problem. Frankly, I think also somebody like a moderator with a little bit more force of personality than Chris Wallace, you know, might have helped. But like the main problem was not about the structure. The main problem was that the structure wasn't enforced, which again is a boring answer, but I think that's the honest answer.
And the next one's going to be a town hall debate. Although the next one is actually Kamala and Mike Pence, which I can't wait for.
Yeah, Kamala and Mike Pence.
We're going to be having a debate watch party for that. So Professor Ben Burgis, what advice would you have given Biden. You knew that he was going to be talking, that Trump was going to be talking in his ear, trying to throw him off. But by the way, how do you think Biden did? I thought Biden did pretty well.
Biden did okay. I mean, I think that he didn't seem super flustered, so that was good. I think he got it a couple of good lines. I think the "Will you shut up, man?" You know, he actually probably played pretty well. I think that it's easier to say this like in retrospect, because honestly, I think any politician put in that situation, where like every single thing that comes out of their mouth is going to be interrupted like that, like I don't know that anybody would have necessarily known how to handle it. I think in retrospect, just rhetorically, right? Like, I think that maybe the issue is that Biden couldn't decide on the spot whether he was just going to pretend that Trump wasn't doing this and just barrel forward. Sometimes he was kind of trying to do that, or whether he was going to like engage with it and try to do good put downs and all that stuff. And sometimes he tried to do that. And I think it would have been a lot better if he just picked one or the other and stuck through it the whole time.
I think he should strike the phrase, "Give me a break." I think that phrase is a horrible phrase ever for anybody. And if my wife said that in a fight to me, I'd be like, "What?" And I also think that I was worried he was going to have all these canned lines and I was going to cringe through them, Biden. But the best moment of the debate, I think most people agree, was when Trump attacked his son for being an addict, and he gave a bumbling, extremely human response.
Well, that actually seemed like a little bit of an odd moment, because it sort of seemed like he thought or was pretending to think that Trump was talking about Bo, not Hunter, at one point, right, in that. So, which I guess maybe, I don't know, maybe it would have played well.
Didn't Hunter get a dishonorable discharge? Wasn't Hunter serving?
Yeah. I mean, Hunter Biden is clearly a very obvious symptom of like the prevalence of nepotism and corruption, you know, with these things, that he'd just been dishonorably discharged because of his drug problem. And he like went immediately from that to this, you know, this patronage job that was very well paid, and you know, whatever. I mean, Hunter, like,
but going after someone with a drug problem never is good for anyone ever. It doesn't. Yeah. I don't. I've never seen that. I'm like, oh, that was pleasant. That was a pleasant moment when you went after my son, my wife, myself for being an addict. I mean, like, he could have gone after Hunter for all of well, he can't go. That's the thing. Trump can't go after anybody for nepotism. It's so hollow because
he should be able to do that without bursting into flames, but you know, yeah. But he does.
There's no question that Trump is not addled. Would you agree that he's articulate? He's in the moment. He knows exactly what he's doing. I don't see the decline that Biden shows.
Yeah, I mean, look, I think that whatever is wrong with Trump cognitively, it has been for a long time, right? Like nothing's changed. And he is together, right? I mean, he's there. That I think that part is absolutely true.
He's doing lines of Adderall before me.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, I wondered about that, honestly. I mean, you know, he was so sped up the whole time, and it was such a departure. I mean, like, I don't hear people mentioning this that much, but it was a weird departure from the way that Trump has been at every previous debate that I've ever seen him in, like, to the point that it's like, yeah, I mean, what is he on right now?
I hadn't heard that speech. David played earlier his speech, I guess, from last night in Minnesota, and he sounded insane. Like,
he sounded like a comic. He sounded like a really good...
Yeah, he did, but he sounded really high, and that's how he gets... That's how we all get in front of a huge audience of people who love us. I understand that, but, I mean, he was really... He really sounded like he was on something in a way that I hadn't heard him in a while. If I don't know.
What is the difference, Professor?
I should probably go. I have to snort some Adderall myself.
What is the difference, Professor Ben Burgis, between an argument and a debate? Because... When I watch Trump, it's an argument. It's not a debate. He changes the subject. It's like fighting with a member of your family.
Well, okay. So
your family, not mine.
Sure. I'm sure you have.
My family observes the Marquis de Queensberry rules when it comes to.
Is that right?
Oh yes, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think that. So an argument in the sense of, you know, give them an argument, is just giving somebody a reason to think that something's true, right? Like backing out, you know, making a case for something, right? That's an argument in that sense. And a debate is like a weird stylized way of presenting arguments. And it's not at all like what makes a good debate performance is only at most 50% having a good argument. The other at least 50, right, is rhetorical packaging. And
looking into the camera.
Yeah, right. And like part of the reason that Trump did so well in the Republican debate, certainly, I think the debates with Hillary, he was generally seen as not doing as well. But in the Republican debates, it's just pure rhetorical packaging that Trump is a pretty talented insult comic when he's at its best. But I don't think we really saw that the other night, because part of the reason it was always so effective is that Trump seemed very like calm and unbothered. Like his affect was almost like he's like standing off in the corner smoking a cigarette and like cracking jokes about what the other candidates are doing. And as you say, he didn't seem at all like that on Tuesday. He seemed like he'd snorted several lines of something. And so that didn't, so whatever. I mean, I don't know how well it played for him. Obviously it made it impossible to debate in any kind of normal way, but it certainly seemed like, all of the defenses of Trump that I've heard or seen have had "but" in there somewhere. It's like, oh, sure, he was. You kind of throw in a few words that indicate this was not a great, this was like not a fun thing to watch or not something that would go well for him. But he's, strong. He's, whatever people said in defense of him. So I think that as far to the extent that these debates matter, which it's not clear that they do, I think that like looking at the polls, at least the one I saw right after about who do you think won, it seemed like Trump had his 40% who would say that he won no matter what happened on stage.
I don't know if you're going to segue over to the Hirschenfelds, but I'd love to know.
Yeah, can you hang on for 1 second?
I should go snort my own Adderall now.
Well, here's what I'd like to do.
You have some? Where do you live? I have a question for all of them.
All right, hang on. Hang on for 1 second.
Could I butt in where I don't belong?
Can I ask you a question before you butt in?
Let me do this. Let's take a quick break, and then we'll bring in Dr. Philip Hirschenfeld, my psychiatrist, my honor, and his son, Ethan. I want to talk about alpha dogs, if we may, because one of our guests is an alpha dog. And Professor Ben, can you stay? Can Professor Ben Burgis and my friend Pete Dominic, can you just stay for 5 minutes? I'd like you to meet Dr. Hirschenfeld and his son. So we'll be.
Can ask my question to all of them.
Okay, but let's. Yes. We'll do it. We'll be right back.
Whose show is this? Mine or yours? This is bullshit.
Well, you have the fancier gear, Pete. So it's. it makes it look like you're the.
My set doesn't look.